What would it look like if you updated your favorite retro handheld gaming system with today's technology? Not to make it more powerful, but to make it the best version of itself. Meet the ModRetro Chromatic, an all-new take on the classic Gameboy Color handheld from 1998. For a head-to-head comparison, we used Lumafield's CT scanner to peek inside both the Chromatic and the original Gameboy. The Chromatic's electronics are seemingly antithetical to the three-decade-old hardware it emulates, and nowhere is this more evident than when comparing the modern ICs on the Chromatic's mainboard to what's visible on the original Gameboy. And even though the Chromatic still uses cartridges and maintains the chunky form factor from the past, the update to tech, like the use of BGA chips and the modern speaker, are very apparent in these scans. So it's time to open up the Chromatic and answer the biggest question on my mind. Will it outlast the original Game Boy Color? Let's find out. The game cartridge and batteries need to be removed before I can move on to the four tri-point screws on the outer case. I'm told they use the tri-point screws purely for stylistic reasons, so as to match the original Game Boy Color. But uncommon screw types are a big repairability no-no as far as I'm concerned. The magnesium alloy frame is sturdy and is undoubtedly a step up from the original Game Boy's plastic shell. That case is bound to be around long after the rest of the electronics are toast. Seems like this is going to be a short teardown, as I can already see the majority of the electronics. The battery tray is held in by three more tri-point screws and uses a simple four-prong connector to attach to the mainboard. Why four prongs? While AA batteries don't need it, the third and fourth cables are data lines for the optional lithium battery pack upgrade. It's also worth noting how repair-friendly a modular battery tray is when compared to the OG Game Boy's soldered-in battery terminals. Moving on, it only takes removing this short screw in the bottom right to release the mainboard. There are two processors on this board. One handles modern functions like Bluetooth and Wi-Fi connectivity, and the second, the FPGA, is dedicated to executing instruction sets exactly as the original Game Boy and Game Boy Color would, meaning that the Chromatic runs like a Game Boy at the hardware level. Underneath the mainboard, there's a few silicon pads sitting against the PBT plastic buttons. Every material used here was designed to recreate the exact same button press feel of the original Game Boys. On the bottom of the shell, we have a very modern looking speaker module held in by a single screw. The pogo pin contact points mean that replacing the speaker doesn't require any soldering, another improvement over the original Game Boy. And finally, the power button and IR window can also be removed from the top of the shell. All that's left is the screen, which is probably the most interesting component in here. The designers of this handheld firmly believe that there's no way to do a multi-console emulator well, and so the Chromatic is designed to be only a Game Boy Color emulator, nothing else. That is especially apparent in the screen, where the pixel-perfect 160x144 resolution exactly matches the original handheld's resolution and color. But the Chromatic team didn't stop there. On the original Game Boy Color, you'd see a black line around every pixel grouping, which made the image look like it was made up of blocks of varying colors. That black outline was a limitation of the LCD technology of the time, something that isn't present in modern LCDs. The custom LCD in the Chromatic goes that extra step and faithfully reproduces those blocky images within the hardware itself. It really is an impressive level of attention to detail. So it may be hard to believe, but what should have been a very cheap LCD is probably the most expensive component inside the entire Chromatic device, and that's because of all the custom tweaks they made to the display. Before we wrap up, let's take a look at those game cartridges. Our Chromatic bundle arrived with a shiny new Tetris game, and undoing the GameBit security screw reveals a very modern looking PCB. The contrast is all the more apparent when we compare our brand new Tetris cartridge to an original cartridge made in the 90s. Aside from the change in PCB color, the manufacturing process for ICs and PCBs has changed significantly. The original game cartridges stored saved data locally to volatile memory, located on this IC here. To retain that data, the cartridge needed to incorporate an independent power source, which is why these cartridges often had a button cell battery inside. Our modern Tetris game also saves game data to the cartridge, but this time there's no button cell battery. Instead, we have 256 kilobytes of ferroelectric RAM that offers ultra-long lasting data retention within RAM without the downside of incorporating a consumable battery. The folks over at ModRetro have already committed themselves to releasing spare parts for the Chromatic, starting somewhere early in 2025. And while we wait to see which parts they're going to release, we're told that the screen will definitely be one of the things that they'll offer replacement replacement parts for. In the meantime, they've already released a disassembly guide on iFixit's website, as well as CAD files for the plastic components. Every indication so far is that they intend to open source as much of the device as possible, which is great news for the device's longevity. The ModRetro team are making a bold claim that the Chromatic is not just a tribute to the Gameboy Color, but the final form and ultimate iteration of the hardware first released in 1998, made to evade obsolescence and stand the test of time. And from what I've seen, I'd have to agree, this probably is the last Game Boy you'll ever need.